Hi everyone, welcome back to this second video in the density series. In the first video, we discussed how to use graduated cylinder to measure volume and then later on calculate density. You're now going to repeat the experiment for the other two columns. For the second column, you're going to do the same experiment, but this time you're going to use a 10 milliliter volumetric pipette to get your sample of water. You're going to pour out that water that you just have in that small beaker. Remember that this was for the graduated cylinder, so we're done with that. So once you pour the water out, you're gonna dry that small beaker well with a napkin, and then you're gonna measure the mass of that beaker again and write it right here. So you may wonder why we don't use the same number that we already did for the graduated cylinder. The reason is because typically we're gonna have some fluctuation in that mass, so it's best to just measure it again for the second time. Once you have the mass of the empty small beaker, you want to transfer water into it, but now you will use a volumetric pipette. The volumetric pipette is a glassware where there is only one mark, which you can see right here. This is different compared to the graduated cylinder, which has a bunch of marks. Because the pipette only has one mark, the goal is to get the liquid's meniscus exactly at that mark. When you get your meniscus to that mark, you're going to write down that your volume of water is going to be 10.00 milliliter. So how do you get the water into the pipette? You're going to use a pipette pump, which is shown here in various colors. First, you're going to unscrew the collar of the pipette pump counterclockwise. Then you're going to insert the pipette into the collar and then turn it clockwise to lock it or to close it. The pipette is now securely inside the pump, and there's a tight seal that ensures that the volume is going to be delivered correctly. And submerge the tip of your pipette into the water sample that you have in that medium-sized beaker. Start turning the thumb wheel, which is this part of the pipette pump, up, and you will see liquid slowly rising into the pipette. Keep doing this until the liquid is about an inch above that mark. So not at the mark. Then what you're going to do is move that pipette tip out of the water, and then you're going to turn that thumb wheel down until the liquid's meniscus is exactly at the mark of the pipette. At this point, you have 10 milliliter in your pipette. What you need to do is move the pipette tip into your small beaker, and then you can press this little lever right here, which is called a fast release lever. When you press it, it will allow all the liquid inside the pipette to empty out into the beaker. There's two different types of pipette that you might see in the lab. If you see the letters TD written on the side of your pipette, this means that the pipette will have a small amount of liquid left in it when 10 milliliter of liquid has been delivered. So if you have a TD pipette, don't push out that last bit of water. However, if you have a pipette that has TC written on the side of it, this means that all the liquid has to come out in order for it to deliver 10 milliliter. Okay, so just make sure that you look at the pipette to determine which type you have. Don't forget that there's only one correct volume you can write for the actual volume of water used when you're measuring with a volumetric pipette. That volume is 10.00 milliliter. There's no other number you can put here, and that's the only way to use the pipette. Okay, so the last glassware you're going to use is a 50 milliliter burette. A burette has many marks, just like a graduated cylinder, so you're going to read the volume with the steps that I described earlier for the graduated cylinder. First, you're gonna have to figure out the size of each mark, then you're gonna have to find out where the meniscus is, and then to finish off, you're gonna have to add one more digit as an estimate of where you think the meniscus actually is. A few things are important to keep in mind when using the burette. First, you're going to fill the burette with your liquid by pouring the liquid through a funnel inserted into the burette. Now you want to make sure that the stopcock, which is at the bottom here, is closed. Otherwise, you're going to have a major leak because the liquid would just stream out of the burette. Now typically, when you just pour the water in, what you're going to see is an air bubble trapped at the tip of the burette, which is shown in this arrow right here. If this is the case, you're not going to be able to use your burette because what you read from the burette will be wrong. So what you have to do is flush out that air bubble first. To do this, simply open the stopcock and let the flow of the liquid push out the air bubble. Once the bubble clears the tip of the burette, like shown here, you can read the volume correctly. Another thing to keep in mind is that the burette starts with zero at the top and its maximum value at the bottom, so it's flipped compared to the graduated cylinder. To read the burette, simply find the meniscus and read its volume. For example, here I'm showing you a liquid inside a burette, and the initial reading should be 9.65 milliliters. What you care about is how much liquid is dispensed or taken out from the burette. You don't really care about how much liquid you have in the burette. The 9.65 milliliter that I just read basically just tells us the initial position of the liquid. Now, in your experiment, you want to dispense about 12 milliliters of the liquid from the burette into the small beaker. So you have to determine roughly where you should stop getting your water out. So for example, if you start about 9.6, you might want to end around 21 or 22 milliliter. In this particular example, if you read this volume right here, it says 24.15 milliliter. So if I subtract the initial from the final, what I'm getting is 14.50 milliliter. Now again, like in other parts, as you notice here, the significant figures in your calculation must be correct. So in your lab report, here you're going to write this 14.50, for example, in here. Again, your number should be closer to 12, so you would write it here as the actual volume of water. Now, in your lab report, there's no designated space to write the initial and final volumes of liquid in the burette, but what I want you to do is to write those values next to the third column, so I know how you get the actual volume of water. Now, of course, what you're going to do is empty that out into the small beaker. You're going to measure the mass of the water again and divide mass by volume to get your density. Once you complete the measurement and calculation for all three data columns, just show those results to your instructor to check that your calculation and your significant figures are correct. After the instructor confirms your result, you're going to write those three density values on the board in a table for the density values for the entire class. Once all the groups complete that table on the board, each student is going to copy the result of the class table to their own lab report. And the purpose of having this class data is for you later on at home to calculate the mean and standard deviation for each of the glasswares. Now, remember that you learned how to do this in your experiment with Excel for last time. You want to compare the precision of the three glassware by calculating the percent error in precision. The larger that percent error, the less precise the instrument. So the way you calculate the percent error is by taking the standard deviation again for each of the instrument and divide by the mean of that instrument. Keep in mind that for both the cylinder and the burette, you want to use approximately 12 milliliters of water for your sample. For the volumetric pipette, you're going to get that water to the mark on the pipette, which corresponds to 10.00 milliliters as the volume. Okay. And lastly, pay attention to significant figures. It's going to be a major part of your grade if you get it correctly. Okay, in the next video, I'm going to describe the other two parts of the density lab.